here's part B of the first FRQ question on the AP practice test. And so this actually goes along with part A, because this is all number one. So I want to point out a couple things here. One is that part B kind of assumes that ArraySum works as specified, even if you didn't implement ArraySum, the method, correctly. You won't lose points on part B as long as your code in part B does what it's supposed to do. So you can completely mess up part A, but still get B correct. It doesn't depend on part A working correctly. The second thing is that because they specify that, look at what it says on the sheet where you're actually going to write the code. It says you must use ArraySum in order to receive full credit. So that means you're going to be calling the method that was written in part A in your solution for part B, and you have to do that in order to get full credit. But this also makes your job easier because you don't have to rewrite code. So let's kind of break down this problem. So in part B, they have you write the method rowSums. And what rowSums does is it basically sums each row. So it takes us the sum of all the elements in each row, and it puts that sum into a 1D array. So they give you an example here. They give you a 2D array. So that's what gets passed into rowSums. This 2D array, basically you want to go through each row, sum all of its elements, and then put that sum into a 1D array. So in row 0, you're going to sum that. It's going to be 16, and then you're going to put that as the 0th element of this new 1D array. For the first row, you're going to sum those values, and you're going to store that sum as the first element of the new 1D array, and so on. For the second row, the sum gets placed into the second element of that 1D array, and then for the third row in your 2D array, you're gonna sum all that and store that into the third element in the 1D array. Okay, so if you remember correctly, in part A, we wrote a method called ArraySum. So the part where we're summing the elements of a 1D array, that can be handled by ArraySum. We don't have to rewrite that. But what we have to worry about is creating a 1D array in order to store all the sums. So we need to know how big to make this array, because if you remember correctly, when you create an array, what you set it as size-wise or length-wise is what it's going to be permanently. You cannot shrink or grow an array. So you have to know the size of it or the length of it when you initialize it. Now, where do we get the length? Well, it'll be the number of rows of the 2D array that gets passed in, because that's how many sums we're going to have. So if we look at mat1, if this is the 2D array that we pass into rowSums, we know that we want to create a 1D array with a length of 4, because there's 4 rows, which means we want to store 4 different integers that represent its sums. Okay, so let's start coding this. Okay, so again, they give you, I'll show you this page real quick, they give you the method header, and it's really important to read this stuff. So again, we're assuming that ArraySum works as specified because we want to be able to call it in our code for rowSums, okay? And then we also need to know that we're going to return a 1D array that has all the sums of the 2D array, which is passed in. Okay, so remember, we have to use ArraySum, which again makes our life easier because we don't have to rewrite that code. Okay. So I know that I want to store all the sums of the rows of my 2D array into a 1D array. So I need to create a 1D array that can hold integers. So I'm going to put int with my double brackets. I'm going to go ahead and call this 1D array sums, because that's what it holds. And again, I need to specify the length of this array. So I'm going to say new int, and then within the double brackets that gets the length of this new array, I'm going to specify that it's going to be the length of the 2D array, because that's how many rows that it has. So if we take a look, for example, at mat 1, the length of mat 1 would be 1, 2, 3, 4, four different rows. Okay, so now that I've specified that, I need to make sure that I iterate through my 2D array to look at each of the rows and then sum all of the elements within it. Okay, so there's a couple ways I can do this, but I'm gonna do it this way. I'm going to create an integer called row number, row num. And I'm going to, I don't know why I put an equal sign there, so int row num, and I'm gonna initialize it as 0. This is gonna keep track of which row I'm in my 2D array. And I'm going to use this in the body of a for each loop. So I'm going to use a for each. So for each 1D integer array within my 2D array. So I'm going to call each 1D array within that 2D array row, because that makes sense. Within R2D. Okay, so looking at this, for each 1D array, so this is a 1D array. 1D array. 1D array, 1D array within R2D, because that's what it gets passed in as. I'm going to use the method ArraySum to sum all the elements within a given row. And I'm going to assign that to my 1D array called sums to a specific index. So I'm going to go ahead and say sums sub row num, which again is initialized as 0, gets array sum sub row. Okay, and then I need to be sure to increment my row num integer. So row num plus plus. And then only once I've exhausted all of my rows in my 2D array do I want to return my 1D array sums. Okay, so let's break this down. Make sure we understand what's happening here. Okay, so this first line. So the first line that says, I'm creating a 1D array called sums that has the length of R2D. Okay, so let's pretend R2D is really this 2D array that gets passed in. Okay. So we know that sums is going to refer to this new array that has the same length of this 2D array. So how many rows does it have? 1, 2, 3, 4. So 1, 2, 3, and 4 with index numbers 0, 1, 2, and 3. And right now it's just going to be filled with all zeros because it's an integer array and we haven't specified values yet. The default value of an integer is 0. Okay, then we create this variable called rowNum. It's an integer. And it stores 0 initially. Here's where stuff gets tricky. We're going to visit each and every row of R2D. So this row, followed by this row, followed by this row, followed by that row. For each of these rows, we are going to store something in each of our positions of the sums array. Okay, so when this starts out, row num is 0, so we're going to do something with position 0. And what we're going to store there is the result of calling array sum. Just realized I put the wrong thing here. Array sum passing in row. And row is a 1D array in MAT1. So the first 1D array that gets passed in is this one right here, row 1. So it's going to add 1, 3, 2, 7, and 3 and return 16. So this element gets replaced by a 16. Then we go to the next row in R2. So that's row number 1. Oh, one other thing. Row num gets increased to 1. Okay. So then we go to the next row, row number 1. We're going to add all the elements in here, and these sum to 32. So we're going to store 32 in sub row num. So sums sub 1 gets 32. And the important thing to know is that we don't have to implement the code that sums all these integers, because we're told that we can just pretend that array sum works as it's supposed to, even if we didn't get the code right. So we're going to just continue here. Row num is going to increase once again. So now we're on row num 2. So that when we get down to the next iteration, it's going to assign sums sub 2. So this position right here. The sum of the next row, so row number 2. And the sum of these numbers is going to be 28. And then finally, we're going to increase row num to 3. And now, we're going to assign sums sub 3 right here, the sum of all the elements in row 3. So the sum of all these numbers is going to be 20. And we've exhausted our rows and we exit out. And then we're going to return this 1D array sum. So this gets returned. And that's how you do part B. Again, in order to get full points here, we have to use array sum. If you rewrite your array sum code here, you will not get full points. You will actually get penalized for that. They want you to assume that this method is specified correctly so that you can actually use it in your code for the solution to part B.